Thank you very much. So good evening, everybody. It's my honor to be here this evening. So I'm going to kick off controversially. Tarmizi, I know what you're doing, and I have one thing that I would disagree with entirely. I don't believe that the facility management information should be in Revit at all. I believe that the information should be kept separate, and I believe there should be a key in the model to the data. So whether it's an equipment ID, whether it's a unique identifier, but the idea of a Revit team updating models with asset information is counterproductive because it requires a very expensive resource in competent Revit staff that doesn't exist, and it means retraining an entire industry. So our approach is very different. We build the data away from the models and we link the two together. So I'll show you that in the presentation.
Okay, sure.
So there's nothing wrong with what you're doing. Don't take it the wrong way, but we have a different way of doing it. So yes, we're going to take the iron BIM, catch me if you can. And basically, just before I kick off, I'm not going to go into a whole presentation about Gamuda and our projects. You can find all that information online. Most of the people on this call will know who Gamuda are. So if you would like to know more information about me and what I'm doing, please follow me on LinkedIn. And it's the best way to keep up on what's happening. So I have a key message this evening, and it's this: the owner is buying the information. So if we're talking about facility information, asset information, or as Charmaine says, linear information, it's the responsibility of the owner to define what they want. The owner has to think of the information as a valuable asset that they have to buy, that they have to maintain. And if they don't see it as a valuable asset, they're never going to get what they want, and they're certainly not going to get what they need. So there's a huge responsibility in the client to specify what they want. In the MRT's case, for the current project, the Line 2 project, the SSP line, the MRT had a very clear mandate of what information they want. So let me show you one example of what a BIM model looks like for anybody who has not seen one. This is a Revit model. It's actually shown in a piece of software called Navisworks. And here you can see the architectural systems. So you can see the ceilings, you can see the interior walls, you can see some of the balustrades. These are all the typical architectural details you will find in a BIM system. This is a structural model, so this is the diaphragm walls, the steel, structural steelwork. So all of this does not tend to end up in an FM system. It tends to end up in these kind of visual tools. What is in FM and is critical to facility management, particularly for these systems, is these live systems. So you've got air pressure pumps, you've got water pumps, you've got sensors, you've got fixtures like fire hose reels, and then you've got all the train operating systems. So you've got speaker systems, you've got security systems, you've got rail sensors, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the data that's required for the asset management tends to come from these very complicated models. And this is what we call a federated model. So this is where we've taken all these different models and put them together. Now, what you're looking at are models that were created by design consultants. And typically, design consultants don't get involved in maintaining facilities. In fact, I've never met an architect, or I've met very few architects, who actually go back into a building 5-10 years after they designed it to see how it's performing. So typically, the information that the architect puts in these models is useful for construction, but it's not necessarily useful for asset management. So one of the challenges that we had on the KVMRT project was, how do we use these models to meet the MRT requirement for asset management? So here you can see a very simple graph of what we have to do. And across the top are the stages of the project. So these are classic kind of railway metro project stages. You've got prelim and pre-final design. You've got final design, which is classic detail design, construction documentation. Final CSDs are when the operator systems are coordinated with the actual railway structure systems. And then you've got the as-built condition. And you'll see at the bottom of the screen, there is an absolute necessity for asset data capture. So from the very beginning of the design, in terms of detail design, we were focused on how do we capture data that we can use for asset management. So if you take these models, the key message here is that the top left model is from the structures. It's typically a structural model. Then you've got the systems models, and you can see some of the sections through them. So how do we take these design models, because that's what they are, they're not construction models, design models, and use them for asset management? So the first thing you have to put in place is you have to have a very robust data management or project information management system. So we call this the single source of truth. Another term for this is a common data environment, or CDE. So on the MRT project, we're using a system called ProjectWise. You could also use a system, for example, Viewpoint for Projects or Aconex. But these systems require a couple of things. They need to be able to track the logins of the people that are using it. They need to be able to link asset information to different attributes. So there could be documents, there could be models, but they have to build a link between the asset information and the design information. So this is why I say we don't want to have all the data in the models, but we want to have a way of linking the assets together. And you can see here a list of all the information that we would typically store on this common data environment. So we've got the models, we've got the design visualizations, and if you look all the way down the bottom, we have to collect all the asset information for facility management. So the system has been designed as a design and construction tool, but it's also been designed to collect the asset information for facility management. So we have a client who specified what they want. We have models that are being built by the consultants, and we have a data management system that allows us to build a system. The next key critical item is that you have to have a asset management strategy, and you need to have a classification system. So it's not good enough to say we want the consultants to build the assets. We actually have to have a way of classifying them. And the building classification system is exactly that. So the KVMRT are using a system called uniclass. It's slightly modified for the MRT, but essentially it's based on this principle. Every station is considered as an entity. And then inside that station, you have to manage the spaces. So facility management is based around spaces. If somebody calls up and says there's a problem with a particular facility, the first thing they'll tell you is what room they're in or what space they're in. So it's based around spaces. Then it's based around systems. So then you structure the data around whether it's a fire sprinkler system, a drainage pump system, an air supply system, a smoke extract system. So you base it around systems. And then you get down to the individual items that require maintenance and management. So they would be what we call products. So that could be a fan, a light, a switch, a particular asset that needs to be repaired. So essentially, every asset in the building needs to have these four pieces of information. So how do we do this? So let me show you a couple of examples. So here's an example where this is the actual entity. So in this case, it's a railway station box. So it's given a code. Now, these codes are not necessarily human readable. They're intended to be machine readable to make it easier to index and find information. So there is always a text definition, but the codes are basically alphanumeric. Then once you get into the space, there is already an existing facility management system in place in the MRT in terms of how they name spaces. So we've adopted that for naming all the spaces in the stations. Now, for those of you who are Revit aficionados, we're using basically rooms in Revit in terms of Revit architecture, or mechanical spaces in terms of Revit MUP. But essentially, we're defining a space by an enclosed area. And then we're determining what elements are in those spaces. So then the systems go through all the spaces. So a particular system is an entire network. So it's not limited to a space, but it's an entire network. So in this case, it's a drainage system. And then when you look for a component in a space or a product in a space, you get right down to the definition of what all these different objects are. In this case, it's a cooling tower. So this classification system is the backbone to everything else that we have to do in terms of collecting data. So once we've identified and set up the classification system, this is put in by the consultants. So as the consultants place systems or place objects in the systems, they have to classify all these products. Now, in our case, we had started modeling the project before the system, or this uniclass system, was finalized. So we had to go back and add in a lot of this classification information with the design consultants into the models. But the designers are responsible for putting the classification in to the models. And then the construction team are responsible for collecting the asset information that's required to actually run the facility. So these are all the asset information that's required. So we have to capture the classification system, the asset tag, which is a unique identifier, and then all this additional information. So and we look for things like when it was installed, et cetera, and we have to collect it for all these systems. Now, this is a massive amount of information. It's very dynamic. It changes all the time, or it gets updated all the time. So we had to come up with a system for doing this in a sensible way. So we're currently doing a digital transformation of our business across all of our business sites. And one of the tools that we're using is a system called FieldView, which is a digital data collection platform. It allows us to create digital forms instead of paper forms. So we can have forms for purchasing permits. We can have forms for quality checking in the factory. We can have forms for delivery of systems to site. We can have forms for first fix, second fix, quality assurance, progress reporting. So we're digitizing the entire normal construction process of tracking the purchase, the supply, the delivery, and the installation of all the assets. And by doing this, it allows us to capture all the asset data and link all that data back to the particular assets in question. So we've digitized the system to collect the data. And that's why we keep the data separate from the models. This data is going into a relational database. And the link between the models and the database is through the asset identification tag. So it's very, very important that the concept is understood, because there's so much data coming in, you don't want to be pumping that back into a tool like Revit. So in our case, we're doing all of these inspections, all of these site assessments for field view, and now we're using it for work inspections, for installation inspections, and for progress monitoring. So one of the challenges is, if you're going to collect all this data, how do you know you have all the data? How do you know what data is yet to be captured? And how do you know what data you've actually got? So what we're doing is we're setting up a construction schedule, which includes all the phases required for the actual MEP systems. So whether that's the purchasing phase, the delivery phase, the testing phase, the commissioning phase, etc. And let me show you an example of what this looks like. So this is a what we call a 4D sequence, or a time-based sequence. Okay. So in the bottom left corner, you can see the details. So you can see all the different systems coming in. And then each of the screens are different views at the same level of one station. And you will start to see the E&M systems popping up. Now, what's happening is we've scheduled out every activity for every piece of equipment that has to be installed into the actual system. And then we've taken all of that information from the schedule and from the planning, and we've used that to set up all the check forms and the digital forms on the field view system. So effectively what we've created is a checklist for every single piece of equipment that has to be installed, for every single test that has to be completed, and for every single handover that has to be done for every piece of equipment in the station. So we're using basically the model as the basis for doing the planning. And then when you're doing, the M&E team are using their checklist, their procedures, their workflows to map out all the tests. And then we're using FieldView to capture all that in real time on the sites. So this is how we're managing the capturing of the information during the construction phase. And that all that information will then be passed to the MRT for operations. So what that means in terms of a very simple workflow, we have guys on site using iPads and Samsung devices to capture the data, which is going through this viewpoint platform. We're then using a database system to pull that information into our reporting system, which then we pass on to the MRT system or MRT staff. So we're using digital systems on site to collect the FM data. So again, the key message here, though, is that we're doing all this because the owner has specified the information that they want. The owner needs to define what they want, so they've done that in their recommendations. And then our team in Gamuda have worked very hard over the last couple of years to work out how to do the system efficiently and effectively. And I'll just leave you one thought. The MRT Line 2 operations does not start for another 18 to 24 months. So we're still collecting the data. So you're going to have to come back in 24 months' time, and I'll tell you whether we've actually managed to give all the data to the owner or not. But we're currently collecting all the data on site using these processes. So I hope you found this useful, and happy to take any questions at the end. Thank you very much.